My name is Martin Ritz, and first of all, I would like to thank you for inviting us, for giving us the honor, the opportunity to present our work here in this exceptional scenario, in this nice city. So our project that we got the Europa Nostra Award 2018 was called CultLab 3D. And I would like to show you how we went all the way from a vision of 3D digitization in an automatic way to the very first automated 3D scanning pipeline. I am representing today here our entire team, the Competence Center Digitization of Cultural Heritage of the Fraunhofer Institute in Germany. It's near Frankfurt at Darmstadt, if you have the possibility to visit us. The Fraunhofer Society, just a quick word on that, we're doing applied research, and we're always trying to be a little bit ahead of the curve of state-of-the-art in different technologies. So we have over 80 institutes worldwide that cover different topics. Ours is computer graphics. I think it's entirely clear why cultural heritage preservation is really important, why we do need 3D digitization. As you can see here in those images before and after, there are so many natural and increasingly man-made disasters. Also, flow of time leaves its toll on cultural heritage. This is the reason why we need digitization, but beyond this, there are so many use cases for a 3D model, one being the documentation of the preservation status of an object, for example, what happens over time to the very same artifact, or the reconstruction of a fragmented or destroyed artifact. For example, if you have a vessel and you only have different shards of it that in addition are scattered all over the world, then you can indeed bring those shards together, forming an entire and complete vessel again in the virtual domain, and you can even make it come physical again using 3D print. Also now 3D printing has gone color, so it's really very close to the original. Museums are profiting from this also in that they can provide more exhibition concepts that are kind of more attractive for younger generations. Also, we heard a lot about virtual and augmented reality already today. This is what you need 3D models for. My favorite point is giving the world access to all the objects, all the artifacts that are maybe sleeping in a lot of archives and are not making the way through to the public. And this also, of course, is for science purposes as well. So what happened so far in the 2D domain? There are digitization campaigns for books, for paintings, and we also have witnessed first steps towards automation. So on the left you see a book scanner where a real old manuscript is scanned, a robotic hand is turning really carefully the pages so nothing is happening. This is already automatic, it might not be fast, but it's automatic. Then there's the first 2D digitization pipeline. This one is a pipeline scanning herbarium sheets in a massive throughput already. But what happens in 3D? 3D is a whole different ballgame. You can already see at this graph that one problem is the variety of objects. Every object has a different, falls into a different class, has a different complexity. And the other thing is all those columns here, red and green, show the digitization effort. And then after digitization, you have post-processing. This graph shows manual digitization. That means you have a tripod, you have a scanner, you move it around the object. Maybe since 2010, the date of this study, maybe something has changed in the sense that you use now rotaries. But what's missing is the intelligence behind the software. So you're just shooting images, you're shooting maybe 3D captures, but you don't have a feedback what actually you need, what set of perspectives to get the optimum quality. So it's clear manual approaches are too expensive, too time intensive, and they need a lot of manpower. So when we founded our department in 2013, we faced the following situation. There is a huge amount of artifacts waiting to be digitized, but digitization in 3D requires sustainable digitization. That means we need a high quality, which is also after 10, 20, 30 years still a viable solution. And we especially need to cover different aspects. For example, optical material behavior. What is that? Well, it's what makes objects in 3D come to life. It's reflectance, it's changing of colors if you change it, if you turn it in front of your eyes, if you change illumination. That's what happens especially to reflective objects, but there's also chameleon colors and much more things that are just lost if you only take geometry and texture. So I already said manual digitization, it's too much time effort. On the other hand, there's no commercial solutions for automation, for automatic color calibrated 3D digitization. So our vision was the one of a fully automatic system, especially providing an operator a one button solution. So they don't have to go into some settings and so on. They just put an object on a conveyor system and they start the process. And of course, this system should fulfill these goals of high throughput and at the same time high quality, which are contradictory goals, of course. And not only, as I said, geometry and texture, but especially also optical material behavior. So there's one important trade-off to solve, or which we actually solved already. So on the one hand, you have digitization time. On the other hand, is hardware cost. So you could solve this with a robot arm, which you already are doing, holding a camera, capturing all the object. But this takes more time. So the other extreme is dome-like structures where you have massive hardware redundancy, many cameras, many light sources shooting in parallel. But this again goes intensely into the financial domain, let's say like this. So you have a real high redundancy, costs a lot of money. So what we did is our first design. We designed a scanner which consists of two rotating arcs that are both rotating about the same axis. One arc is holding cameras, the other one is holding light sources. And using this structure, we can mimic a hemisphere of both different observing camera perspectives and light perspectives. This is important, or actually crucial, if you want to capture material properties as well. This is how it happened in the workshop. First, we built a wooden prototype. And just to test this approach, if it's working in principle, and you can see the blue box here. This is a little camera, 10 megapixels back in the day. And this is me with a final prototype on already our conveyor system, which was already constructed. So this is a system that can carry artifacts automatically from one place to another. And this is what CultLab 3D looks now. So you have a fully automatic scanning pipeline. And maybe please play the video already. So you have a fully automatic scanning pipeline, which consists of two different scanning stations. It's a bit like in the automobile industry where you have collaborative machines working. So in the end, you see this just described cult arc 3D, and the objects, the artifacts, we always call them objects, but we're technicians, so the artifacts are placed on glass discs. And this is the only point of contact between the machinery and the artifact, which is really important for artifact safety. So why are those disks transparent? Well, the reason is artifacts have a bottom side as well, so we capture at a certain moment in this scanning process from below. It is when this bridge underneath the artifact is opening, giving way for a volume of vision from some cameras from below. In this first stage, you are here, maybe note this little tablet. This is all controlling the entire system. You only hold a QR code, which basically holds the ID, the inventory number of the artifact, because of course you have a lot of data coming out of the system. You want to bind it correctly to the data in the database. And also we have approaches already for semantic interlinking, meaning for different projects, we can combine pictures, we can combine 3D scans and so on, we can do 3D annotation. So now the first stage is complete and the artifact is transported automatically to the second station or robotic arm with a camera. So what we do with this entire system, we combine the strengths of both systems. Fast digitization on the first station and accurate after processing on the second stage. So what happened, we computed a 3D model, a rough geometry, we call it, the shape of the object, to identify what are the most important perspectives around the object that are still missing if you capture from a hemispherical domain. And this is fully automatic and intelligent because it's adaptive to the respective geometry of each object. Now you can see there in the back is already the next artifact. So this pipeline can do two objects at a time. And we're at 5 minutes per artifact. So every 5 minutes, you can put another artifact in, another one goes out, back into safe storage. OK, so you can terminate the video. So this pipeline called CultLab 3D is what we basically received the Europa Nostra Award in 2018 for in the category research, in the presence of Maestro Placido Domingo and also the German president of state. And since we are, there's already the next video, since we are a department which is looking into 3D digitization, of course, the first thing that came to mind, what to do with such a prize, we digitized it. And that's the result. So this, by the way, this prize is pretty heavy, and we received it only afterwards, after the ceremony, because it's kind of a little bit dangerous, right, if there is the head of state present. So yeah, we received it kind of after the entire celebration. What I want to show you here is, if you look at this object, it's very complex already. It is metallic, it's reflective, it has cavities, occlusions. That's exactly what scanners don't like. But you can see it's basically in perfect quality. There was hardly any post-processing, meaning closing of holes or changing the geometry that came out. It's basically what you get out of our system. So it's not only the 3D scanning suite that we develop. We also do a lot of side projects. So one very prominent example is the digitization of the Pergamon altar in Berlin. The other one is the Berlin Philharmonie. We digitized both. In the case of the Pergamon altar, I just want to show you some results. It consists basically of 113 meters of frieze, which are more than 2 meters in height, a lot of sculptures on it. And on the right-hand side, you can maybe note this link. Everyone right now can access this 3D model in the web browser on my mobile phones. This massive data set has been reduced, also using our technology to show it on the devices. You can interact, you can click on it. And for me, most important, I don't like to read a lot of long text in the museum. I can click on those sculptures and they tell me who they are. So there's a lot of figures, they can tell me what they're doing in this and that scene, what's this fight scene about, and so on. So this is what you can do with this novel museum concept as well. And here comes the next video. So in the recent time, we have moved a little bit more towards the second scanning station, which is the robotic arm. Maybe it comes, maybe not, we'll see. So what do we have here? Usually it's not green, but you can get the idea, I guess. So we have improved the robot. Now it's a standalone station, meaning we don't need the entire pipeline. We just it's sufficient if you have this robotic arm, and it's transportable. It's even more affordable now. And what it does in this state, this is a 100 megapixel camera. It's capturing against light, so it's extracting silhouettes. It's actually deriving a coarse model on which basis, again, it can find out what are the most vital perspectives around the object. And it doesn't matter what you put on this turntable, what size, what shape, it derives this automatically. This is the intelligence behind the software which we developed, because it's surface adaptive. That means I have a high resolution camera and a lens that we use to capture at a very short distance. If you do some photography, you know this is complex because the depth of field is very narrow, only some centimeters. And our system is able to ensure that every point on the surface is at some point in optimal focus. So that's what we achieve with this system, fully automatically. Okay. So I'm already now at the most current breaking results. This is really fresh. A lot of optical scanning technology has problems, or most of them basically, with shiny surfaces, with metal surfaces. Sorry? Oh, yes. Thank you. So I was just saying most recent technology of scanning, optical technology, has big problems with shiny surfaces. For example, metal and so on. So one solution used to be coating, spraying, which is of course not good for cultural heritage. Our results now, we achieved scanning without any pre-processing. So we can directly scan materials like metal and shiny materials with hardly any post-processing. And this we achieve using optical and algorithmic tricks. So on the optical domain, we can separate entirely diffuse from specular. Specular is what is annoying us in terms of getting geometry out, and diffuse is what gives us the information we need. Then it's called next best view planning, because we always know what's the next best view, very straightforward. So using this algorithm, we can avoid entirely angles where we have total reflections, which is important for metallic surfaces. So this is our current results. We were at the Reis Engelhorn Museum in Mannheim, and they have a collection of real nice Java gold objects. And you might think these are photographs. They are not. They are 3D renderings from one perspective. And we could illuminate them. We could shoot them from any perspective we want, because they are 3D models. I'm just going to show my final video here. So these are the single measurement points. These are 20, 30 millions of measurement points. This is a triangular topology. It's a surface mesh on which colors are projected afterwards. Of course, we take back the reflectance afterwards, and now you see it's still golden. And what we're looking at is smaller than 3 centimeters. You're looking at an actual earring out of gold. And we scan this directly without any post-processing and without any additional effort needed to clean the model or to do any other steps afterwards. So with this, I'm at the end of my quick introduction of what we're doing, what we're working on. Please visit our websites. Maybe I can see the last slide once more. Visit our websites, and you're always welcome to visit us in our laboratory at Darmstadt, close to Frankfurt, to see our latest tech. Thank you.